Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you again for joining us this week virtually here at St. Luke's in Colorado Springs. And also I want to thank you for the continuing dialogue from so many of you here week to week now that we're doing this new format and the emails and the texts and such that I get. And I have a feeling that by the time I'm done with this one, I may be hearing from some of you again, because this week's text really, really, really made me think. And the text that I'm referring to is from our epistle lesson. And the word specifically in the very beginning of it, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed. Now this should sound pretty familiar to you. If you've been at St. Luke's for even a short period of time, I'm sure you have heard this part of Paul's epistle to the Romans. In fact, a couple years ago, we made it our theme of mission and discipleship. And in doing this, I warned then how we now live in a post-Christian world. And because of that, we live in a world that cares more about secular mores and values than Judeo-Christian ones. And as I'm speaking to you today, in August of 2020, this argument is just as true, if not more true, and more so than it was back then. So this message for you today is not going to be a rehashing of this particular discussion of what post-Christendom means, but rather, we're going to be looking at this text from another angle, one that a couple years ago, admittedly, I had not even thought about. That is, what happens when our faith communities are the ones that have been transformed by the world? What happens when it's our faith communities, not just our culture, but our faith communities, when they are the ones that have been transformed by the world? Now, does that sound a little far-fetched? Well, I certainly don't think it does. And so let me explain this to you this morning as soon as we pray together. Please pray with me. Gracious God, we thank you so much for gathering us here safely today. And we ask by the power of your Holy Spirit that we, as we hear this word, may grow in our faith and also in our discipleship, learning to love and to serve you and our neighbor even more every day. Word of God, we ask that you speak to us as we hear this message. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, in the United States, we live in a culture that inundates us with an advertising, so to speak, that's designed to pretty much conform us to this world. And we know this for many reasons, but if you want to just go simply on larger factual things, we see around us every single day how the media and the marketing industry spends billions upon billions of dollars annually to flood televisions and websites and billboards and emails and regular mail with these messages. They seek to define us as consumers, as individual economic units existing for the sake of larger market shares. And in addition, each day, our families, friends, organizations, religions, political parties, and society at large pressures us to fit in, to stay within those bounds of tradition, custom, or practice, that mark of who we are supposed to be. So we know, and we have talked about this in the past, that not conforming to this world, well, it can be quite a tall order. Because we know that the world, because of sin, will fight at every stage to convince us to look the other way rather than glimpse the injustice, hatred, oppression, greed, and violence that surrounds us. What it takes, we learn from Paul, is a transformation, a renewal of the mind through the power of the Holy Spirit to detach ourselves from the world's attempts to occupy us with things that simply, in the grand scheme of things, do not matter. And Paul implores us in this text to shake off the effects of the world and to attend to things that do matter. Again, as he writes in the second verse of Romans, to discern the will of God, what is good, acceptable, and perfect. So we know, and it shouldn't surprise us by now, that this is what secularism tries to do, to pressure us to conform to its values and to its relativism. But what happens when the church succumbs to this as well? This week, I read an article by a man called Grayson Gilbert in the online website Patheos. And you can look it up yourself and read it. I'll be sharing parts of it with you in my message today. Now, I want to be very, very clear, especially if you're pausing this and going to read the article right now before I start. I do not endorse or even agree about half of this article, half of what he writes. But in doing so, and yes, folks, in 2020, we can read stuff from people we sometimes disagree with. What it does raise in this article is some very interesting questions that I think we need to talk about in our own context. With this in mind, just to give you a little background, this pastor's biography says that Grayson completed his Master's of Divinity degree at Moody Theological Seminary and is currently a pastor pursuing church planting. And just so you know, as of this recording here on Saturday, that article, which came out on the 13th of August, is still at the top of the Patheos website under the name of, quote, "Over half of the church does not believe in the gospel." Now, you have to understand why I would click on something like that. Obviously, they did a good job marketing it to me, right? I think to myself, half the church doesn't believe in the gospel. I have to read this thing. And I thought to myself, well, I'd probably get like a paragraph in and go, oop, next. But I read the whole gosh darn thing. And what I initially thought was quite a radical claim. I thought, well, maybe he's not that far off. So let me share with you how he introduces the beginning of this article. He writes, "It ought not to be a shock to us that a majority of professing Christians don't know the gospel or the good news of Jesus Christ. Don't misunderstand me to say this is inconsequential. It isn't. It's disastrous and will prove to have eternal consequences on a rather large group of people who have little to no concept of what the gospel actually teaches about the fundamental nature of mankind, the problem of sin and judgment, and yet how this problem is also resolved in the person and the work of Jesus Christ. That is profoundly significant. What I am saying, though, is that we ought not to be shocked by this, mainly because this hasn't been something hidden from plain sight." He goes on, "Everything we have been seeing in terms of the large, incredibly divisive in-house debates in the evangelical world is a microcosm of this reality. What we're dealing with in a nutshell is a worldview competition with a secular worldview emerging as the dominant one in the church." Now, a parenthetical here, because this is important. I know that we here at St. Luke's are not evangelicals in the sense that Pastor Grayson writes and probably in the circles that he runs in. We are, however, part of the conservative remnant of what was a great Protestant tradition of Martin Luther and Lutheran theology. Yet even though we have that difference, there are still many parallels that we share. The largest one being that the secular world and the progressive movement lumps us together as, quote, the conservative ones, which they will say in a condescending way and with a tone as a label of derision. So yes, what he does write here, the issues he bring up, they do apply to us in many ways, which is why it's important, I think, to hear out his argument and why I got so enthralled with this article. But remember, though, especially if you're reading it, I feel compelled as I have to say this again, because I don't know what kind of emails I would get if I didn't. I do not take this article as gospel, and I don't agree with a lot of what's in there. But rather, I think what he poses is thought-provoking for us here, and especially in this next section, I'm going to explain why. Pastor Grayson in this article goes on to say, part of the problem is a discipleship issue, no doubt. Shallow, emotionally laden Christian thinking has dominated the vast majority of space in the Western evangelical world. It didn't take terribly long for me to realize this even as a new Christian. Grayson says, I remember going to a conference for college students, and I'd been a recent convert out of a long-standing atheism. And a gentleman who ran Campus Crusades invited me to come along because he felt it would be helpful to me. He goes on, now I'd just become a Christian months prior, and I was devouring resources and devouring scripture simply because I had lived my life up to that point as someone wholly devoted to a secular worldview. He says, everything came down, crashing down for me, which in one sense was quite easy. Because when I did convert, I understood that coming to Christ meant a total overhaul of everything I knew, believed, and practiced. For me, it was a paradigm shift. However, I didn't grow up in the church, so the paradigm shift wasn't turning from a false understanding of the Christian faith to a true one, but from an atheistic, nihilistic worldview to a Christian worldview. He then goes on to explain, when you have someone turning from falsehood to truth within the Christian worldview, I believe that process is arguably more difficult because it requires a careful deconstruction and reconstruction so as to keep the truth of the Christian worldview intact while ditching the secular cultural Christian worldview. He says, for my atheistic worldview, it was a much less delicate task that required a fair amount of pyrotechnics. But the goal was to level the building and start with a brand new foundation. He continues and with a story then, later in the article. He says, I came to a conference with brand spanking new worldview that while complete with all the foibles of the new Christian who finally has the world figured out, this did actually help me see that there were many college-age Christians at this conference with me who had little to nothing figured out. And I, the new Christian, was fielding basic questions to lifelong Christian kids who were never taught anything of substance in their churches, let alone from their parents. He then goes on in this article, I won't read this part, but to talk about many of the questions he was bombarded with. And they were quite interesting questions, from basic Christian moral questions to ideas of worship and sacramental theology that wasn't even close to the biblical worldview, but tried to take the same advertising, marketing type things and say, hey, they work in the secular world, let's just incorporate them into the culture of the church. So that's what he does in the next part of the article, but he continues. These are not bad questions that people ask, but they're basic ones. He says, none of these, even for me, was that difficult. And here is where, in the article, in relation to our text from Paul, he gets very controversial and really starts to make me think. And as this article was actually shared in an NILC pastor's forum, I can tell you in advance, there were several people that said, well, you know, this is maybe even a little legalistic. Well, that is this section I'm about to read to you. But there were many others that said, no, I think he's spot on. So see if this catches your attention in either a positive or a negative way. I don't see how it can render you neutral. He says this, if you've been a Christian for more than 5 years and you haven't ironed some of these basic things out yet, there is either a fundamental problem of discipleship, willful ignorance, or both. If these are still unresolved issues in your mind as a new Christian, I can help you. I sympathize with you a great deal because I know some of that is difficult to work through, especially since there are a plethora of bad answers out there from well-intentioned people. However, if you've been a Christian for a reasonable length of time and these are still lingering doubts in the back of your mind, you need someone to tell you point blank you have a serious issue on your hands. You, that is the experienced Christian he's referencing, should be able to help a new Christian out with these things and walk with them through the process. And this is where I really struck. He says, and if you can't do that, you either need to leave the church you're at or find a better one. Or repent, take up and read the Bible, and then put into practice what you read. So, I read this, and I thought, whoa, there's no way he can be right. And I was actually in the camp of some of my fellow pastors, which said, well, I get the idea, but this sounds very legalistic. No, this is too far. This is going too far. This is too radical. But then at that point in time, I stopped when I was reading this article, and I paused for a second, and I thought of my own faith story. I grew up in a Midwestern Lutheran church. My mother is still, though she's not able to attend church currently in the pandemic, a very strong disciple of Jesus Christ who's modeled that for all three of her children. When my dad was alive, at least in his later years, because of my mom and because of his new friends at church, he became a strong Christian witness and was a lay preacher at our church. And as you know, I went to a Lutheran college and what was, I guess you could charitably at least call it, a historically Lutheran seminary in Pennsylvania. Then obviously, here I am, I'm a Lutheran pastor. And yet, what really convicted me, what really struck me, is that there have been so many times in my adulthood, as an ordained Lutheran pastor, by the way, that I actually would not have been able to meet this seemingly low standard. That is, on the basics of the faith, even as an ordained pastor, at a point in time in my adulthood that I can trace back to not that long ago, I'm not sure I could do apologetics. That is, I'm not sure I could be there to help answer those basic questions. And so then it really started to intrigue me. And as embarrassed as I was, I decided to continue reading. And he went on to explain this even further, which struck my heart, and I'm sure maybe it struck your heart too. He says, we need to walk in what we already know, which means to say that while it is a discipleship issue, it simultaneously isn't at the same time. Part of this issue is owing to what I'd call perennial piecemeal spirituality that many Christians have embraced. He defines it as such. It's an amalgamation of clashing worldviews that people don't realize are in direct competition of one another, namely because professing Christians don't have a vigorously consistent worldview. And again, part of this is a bound discipleship issue, yet the other part is owing to that base of Christians who have been exposed to a comprehensive Christian worldview and yet still reject it. Now let me pause here, because personally for me this hits the nail on the head, and as I said earlier, I would say before I came to St. Luke's 10 years ago or so, what he's going to describe now is me, okay? This was me, just as little as 10 years ago. He said, here I speak to a group of extremely bright, well-schooled Christian thinkers who simply agree to disagree with some of the philosophical and theological underpinnings of the historic faith. They knowingly depart from biblically comprehensive worldview because the ideological underpinnings of other movements or other cultural beliefs are attractive to them. They take the time to digest resources filled with poisonous rot and inevitably come to the conclusion that it's not all that poisonous, nor is it all that rotten. And 10 years ago, that was me. And I'm sure even sometimes nowadays, unfortunately, that is me too. And then I notice in some of my very closest friends something similar to this. Or perhaps they ditch the proper understanding of doctrine so they can continue to hold on to their pet social or political issue. They look at men condemned as heretics within the other church for heresy and craft lengthy arguments to say that they were simply misunderstood in their own time. It can be any number of things that had caused this cobbled worldview to exist, but at the risk of oversimplifying the issue, there is a disparity in their worldview because people are lying to themselves for one reason or another. So what he is saying, what he's drawing out here, is that not only has the gospel been lost to rather a large group within the broad visible church, but even those within the invisible church have lost their mores, and this only exacerbates the issue. Again, wow. Now, as I sat down to write this today and contemplate about this, I realized that I've gotten to this point, and this sermon has already been fairly long compared to my norm ones. So I think I'm going to stop here shortly and call this part one of what's going to be a two-part series that I've already started writing that will happen next week, to which I say, thank you, Holy Spirit, for giving me a heads up on that one. But anyway, Let me wrap up this first part with this reflection on this article and also on our text for Romans by calling it part one, the diagnosis. Again, a couple years ago, I preached at length on this text as a warning not to be conformed to the secular world. Today in the diagnosis, I'm extending this warning not to be conformed as well to on or extra biblical Christianity. For, I'm sorry to give you this warning, but I think you know the church is made up of sinners too, and it will lead us astray as well. Which is why discipleship and its living out in prayer and immersing ourselves in Scripture is so important and so essential for each and every one of us that make up this church. The diagnosis is, we don't need to just be worried about the secular world outside of here. We also need to make sure that we look at it within our own homes as Christians as well. Folks, this discussion I want to start with you this week is about real life faith. And while there is a lot to worry about nowadays, a lot to be wary about in this world, no matter where anyone is, any of us are in our faith journey, what's important is that we remember that we are called children of God. That's our name. You are a child of God. A God who loves you so much that he sent his son, Jesus. And because of this, therefore, do not be conformed to the world or even to those on or extra biblical things that occur in the church. No. Be conformed and then transformed in your heart and your mind to the one who is Jesus the Christ. Stay tuned next week for part two. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.